Total nerd if I fly a hang glider, right? Okay. Not maybe your typical professor here. I'll tell you, from the professors I've met here, I've been impressed with your school, and I am bucking for a job shortly after tonight's talk. But thank you for coming tonight. One of the things, I have to set some guidelines down for this. And as it was billed, this is an apolitical talk. We will not get into politics tonight. I will not get into politics tonight. And if we ask questions, please don't try to ask me about, well, should we have this type of gun control? Or does this gun control work? Or doesn't it work? I'm not an expert in those questions. I cannot answer them. Nor will I, even if I were, because my whole point of doing this lecture series has been to get us to understand the nature of firearms from a mechanical, physiological standpoint, without getting into the emotional parts, the parts that have seemed to have destroyed any chance of achieving any sort of political ends to a problem which we all agree is happening in this country. So tonight, please bear with me with the no politics stand. And I encourage you, nay, I beg you, if you believe I am getting political, please call me on it, because I will call you on it. And I'm not here to take sides on this. But in full disclosure, there is a side of me that has a favorite on this, and it's because I am a gun person. You're seeing some pictures of me here firing at 600 yards in the top left corner, of shooting little clay targets in the top right, of doing pistol combat style competitions, as well as those with rifles. It does present me, leave me in a biased standpoint. But I have to tell you, my contention is this, that unless you understand the use of firearms from this standpoint, you cannot talk about the mechanics of firearms or how people use them. And if you do not know how firearms work mechanically or how they can and can't be used, then you're, I would argue, less likely to ever be able to come up with good laws that would fix the problems that we believe we have concerning firearms. This gives me part of my expertise here tonight, as does the time that I've spent training hundreds of shooters to use firearms, as has the time that I've spent with my colleague, Chad Nye, you see with a firearm in the lower right-hand corner there, working with professional journalists. This was recently down in Connecticut with reporters that covered the Sandy Hook massacre. Yeah, it was an interesting experience to work with those individuals who were there that day and who had to figure out how to talk about this so that people understood the issue. And so that's where my expertise comes from, those from, as well as one more place too. You know, I build this, what Hollywood journalists and shooters get wrong about guns. Well, one of the things that I did with a fun class at my college was to explore the 10 most popular movies as far as ticket seats sold that dealt with modern firearms. And you're seeing a list of them there. And we did a content analysis of those movies, which sounded like fun, and the students absolutely hated it by the end of the class because it's a lot of ugly, terrible work. It's boring. But we did it, and what we found out was much of the information that I'll present to you tonight. Now, I'm going to hit three areas here before we do the Q&A, but I want to pause between each area to allow you to ask some questions and so you don't forget. But if you want to recap those at the end too, please feel free to do so. And I have no problem if you want to politely interrupt me at any point in case I make an assumption about knowledge that isn't there, or if I'm just unclear and have timed my drugs wrong or something. So we'll go from there. Well, I thought that joke would go over better after the first one with the, but okay. okay, tough crowd. okay. I do have that little bag going around with the cartridges. Where are we at with that? So we're almost through the whole group. Good. We'll get to that as we come along here. So let's talk about lethality first. Just curiosity's sake, does anyone know what that movie's from? Thank you. Very good. Okay. One of the things we found very quickly from looking at movies is, how about this movie? Know it? Thank you. okay. Woo. We have some film fans here. They don't miss. And that's kind of been the case in all of the history of Hollywood or media's use of guns. I can still remember watching The Lone Ranger in black and white when I was a kid, or the John Wayne movies, or The Rifleman, which is actually playing again on television now. The Saint, yeah, he never misses. Guess what? It doesn't work that way at all. Nor does it work the same way that we think about that when the good guy shoots the bad guy immediately falls to the ground. We're going to talk about that. It doesn't work that way either. Because making the shot is hard. And making a shot that stops someone is very hard too. And before you understand the mechanics of this, the physics and physiology, we really should be cautious about making any rules about firearms. Look at this statistic here. Police officers miss their target from ranges from me to you 6 out of 10 times, at best. There is a story that I've been told that I can't track down as true, but it wouldn't surprise me, of a undercover police officer walking into an elevator one day, pushing the button to have the doors closed, only to turn over this way to see the other man in the elevator with him, and both of them recognizing each other. The other guy was a crook that he came to arrest. They both drew their firearms and emptied them, and neither one of them was struck inside of an elevator. Yeah. Now, why does this happen? Well, there's multiple reasons for this. One, because they're in a life or death situation. And if any of you have ever have been in a high stress situation and so forth, has anyone ever been in a serious car accident? Okay. What were you like immediately after? Were you shaking? Oh, okay. You're used to it. Gail?
I was absolutely shaking.
Right. Could barely stand. Mm-hmm. Maybe had the old knee wobble. Mm-hmm. I have one knee that just starts to go bonkers. Just one. Don't know why. Your ability to see diminishes. You get a literal tunnel vision that narrows down your sight. Your fine motor control disappears. You tremble. You shake from the adrenaline urge. And in these situations, it's no wonder that police officers whose lives are at risk, and whose other lives are at risk, and they recognize this, are unable to do the task that they have been trained to do. Picking up something simple like a bottle of water could be near impossible, not to mention holding a firearm and squeezing a trigger in such that you've aligned the sights appropriately to make a hit on target. So this is one of the interesting problems that we have here and why many of the issues about guns are confused. Right now, legitimately, we know that there are police officers who have absolutely abused their power, who have willingly murdered other individuals. But we also know that there are police officers who have probably been doing their duty well, yet it appears like they were bloodthirsty animals, when in fact, the reason they emptied 20 rounds at the suspect was because they didn't hit him. And these numbers backed up by multiple studies from police departments in the city of, and as well as the state of New York in particular, clearly show that it is much harder to hit a target than you think. The ability to shoot a knife out of someone's hand, it's myth. Unless you were a Navy SEAL who's been at war for years and is used to that kind of thing, maybe a Chris Kyle type, what movie was that?
American Sniper.
Thank you, I knew our movie people there. Unless you're that type of individual, you're not going to perform on that level. Which is a bad thing here in the mythologies among gun owners then too, is that, wait a minute, cops can't do this. Here am I, as an average gun owner who probably has had nowhere near the amount of training of a police officer, what are the odds of that individual doing it well? They're not very good. That's not to say that people haven't defended themselves well with firearms, most of the time without having to fire a shot. Thank you. I'll tell you, just set that down for now, and I'll come back and grab it here. But it's something that we all need to think about here in terms of how we control laws, how we oversee police, what perhaps restrictions we do or don't put on individuals' right to carry firearms, and how we consider the use of lethal force. Knowing that from a mechanical standpoint, this is incredibly challenging to do. The myth here of dying is a fascinating one. I'll go ahead and let you read this. Actually, I'll read it aloud for you. An individual may sustain a fatal gunshot wound and yet engage in physical activity. Occasionally, forensic pathologists encounter cases in which an individual, after incurring a fatal gunshot wound of the heart, is able to walk or run hundreds of yards and engage in strenuous physical activity prior to collapse and death. This is from Dr. Vincent DeMayo. I think that's how his name is pronounced. I'm not sure. He is the world's, as I understand it, the world's leading forensic pathologist and expert in gun wounds. He writes the textbook that is used in all of the forensic schools when it comes to doing forensic studies of gun fatalities. So what we have to understand here too, and again I'll point out in terms of police officers, there's another reason police officers keep shooting when the suspect has already been hit. It's because in not all cases are they disabled. We've seen lots of videos lately where it seems like people go down pretty quickly. But I remind you that these are anecdotal incidences and not cases of complete sort of situations here. It's important that we recognize this. I'm not saying that we excuse bad cops. I'm saying that we have to understand that it is possible for somebody to keep coming quite some time after they have been hit. That's an important part for gun owners to consider. And are you willing to recognize that you may in fact need to shoot an individual multiple times to stop the threat that you perceive? Can I take any questions at this point? Yes, sir.
So you say may and occasionally, but you know, and they're good to get general ideas that these things happen, but what are the exact numbers? You know, is this like a 1 in 10 thing or is
it's I wish I could answer your question, and you actually, it's like I gave you $20 to ask that question. It's perfect. The truth is we really don't know how this works because we can't put people in a lab and shoot them and see what happens. Thank God. You know, we got rid of that with the Nazis. That was not a Nazi joke, please. That was a serious statement here. We know that it does happen, but because we don't keep really good count from police records of was it a one-shot stop, which bullet actually killed the person, it's hard to keep track. And I'll give you a great example. You may have heard this situation here. where a police officer was charged with murder. And some of you may have seen the video. They stopped the car. They thought the people in the car had guns. The police opened up on the car. They shot it multiple times. And then right at the end, the police officer jumped up on the hood of the car and emptied his magazine, 14 shots, through the front windshield. He was charged with murder. He was acquitted because they couldn't tell which bullet actually killed the people. And you can't charge someone with murder unless you can prove that they fired the killing bullet. So to measure these things, police departments don't keep track of this. The Department of Justice doesn't. The FBI doesn't. What we have is lots of accumulated anecdotal evidence that this happens some of the time, but I can't tell you specifics. We know that it happens.
Is there a consensus among the medical community, or are they also varied on what their ideas are?
There aren't enough experts out there who are even qualified to talk about this kind of thing. And that's the sad part, where the media has failed miserably. For example, every time there's a mass shooting, I'll get to your question, sir, I will, thank you. They go, oh, let's go talk to the radiologist in the hospital about what type of gun would he use and how bad it was. Well, the last person you should talk to about deaths in a hospital for about gunshot is a radiologist. Radiologists only see patients who live. It's the forensic pathologist who sees the patients who died. And sure, this radiologist sees some terrible wounds, but they ain't half as terrible as the ones that took the people's lives. Yes, sir.
Did he reference the case that happened with the FBI in Florida in the late 80s or mid-80s?
He talks a lot about different sorts of cases there, and I, off the top of my head, I can't recall how much he referenced it, but if you have it, absolutely. That was the one that with the FBI that kind of changed him to get away from service revolvers and the whole situation. Absolutely, that kind of situation. But I'll give you this name again if you want to get it again, if you didn't get it. Yes, sir.
Apropos accuracy, how about military shooters?
I'll tell you what, I'm going to have a little part later that may answer some of this, and if it doesn't, ask me again, okay? Right. I don't want to spoil my surprise here. Oh, actually, it's coming up next, so I'm glad I spent that $20 to have you ask that question. You too. They're going, what $20? I didn't get anything. So one of the things when we think about lethality here is, well, do guns make the difference? Yes, they do, but not all the time, and only in certain situations. And there's no real data, as you asked, that can make this easy to understand. So I actually put this information together myself, just out of curiosity to see what happened. I'm not telling you that this is definitive proof of anything, but I think it indicates that I'm on the right track with some of this. For example, I'm taking a look at firearms used against American soldiers in four different wars here. The first, the Brown Bess musket, what the British used. You had to pour the powder in, put the ball in, get a ramrod. It took a really, really good rifleman could fire 3 shots a minute. Okay. Wow. World War I, a German Mauser. A rifleman was expected to be able to fire 20 to 30 rounds a minute. With accuracy at that war period.
British even more.
Maybe so, but we know the military, even to this rate, rates a practical rate of fire between 12 and 20 rounds. 20 to 30 for a sustained rate of fire, meaning I'm aiming reasonably well, but I'm really trying to shoot fast. We go to World War II, which surprisingly for the Germans, for the longest time, the frontline soldiers were still using the same rifles that their grandfathers were using in World War I. We get to Vietnam, the AK-47, a full-fledged assault rifle, still the most popular and maybe best assault rifle in the world, which can fire, assuming that you could keep it fed without having to stop and that it didn't melt, as much as 800 rounds in a single minute. With a reload, we're looking more along the lines of about I think I give it to you a little bit later, and I won't do it, but it's really more along the lines of like 100 rounds a minute or so. But you're going to have to do a couple reloads to do that. So what I did then was say, well, if better guns, more rapid-firing guns, easier-to-use guns are more lethal, we should see that on the battlefield. The table here lists battlefield injuries and battlefield deaths for these same wars. And look at the differences. There almost aren't any differences. The rate of death versus casualty is almost the same. Now, one real bad weakness of this study, and I can't fix it, I tried, is that I don't know how artillery impacted this.
Well, if it's taken in combat deaths, would you assume artillery would just be a natural factor then?
It would, but if there were changes in artillery at different points here, it may have been that they resulted in more deaths than guns, and ideally we'd want them all to be equal. But if you look at the number of people killed versus those injured, the same, regardless, pretty much the same, regardless of the type of weapon. And basically a lot of what it comes down to then is it's the person using the firearm that makes the gun especially lethal. All firearms are incredibly lethal. Yes, sir.
And are you taking into account, like in the War of 1812, they were shooting musket balls. The rifles weren't actually rifled.
Right, they're muskets, yes.
At that point. And so you'd have to be, you know, you're not shooting from hundreds and hundreds of yards
true.
Away. You're very close together.
This is only counting hits, though.
Okay.
Yeah, and in all cases, hits regardless. And an interesting thing, I'd much rather be hit by a round from an AR-15 in the chest than I would by that musket ball. Because it's 0.79, yeah. I think, or 7.8. I can't remember
like
the brown vessel.
7.8.
7.8 of an inch versus 0.223 of an inch.
But you have the velocity of the 5.56.
This is true, and we have to start to measure kinetic energy. And really, a lot of it's going to depend about where did it hit you at. If they both hit you in the head, you're dead. Both hit you in the heart, liver, you're dead. The one will take your arm off, the other will not.
Well, yeah, but also the 5.56 also fragments, too.
Whole other thing, depending. That's one of the mythologies that may or may not be true, and I'll try to get back to that one for you. Sir, you asked earlier, does this begin to help to answer the question that you were asking?
I have to say no, because my question was...
Come back to it again, because I've forgotten what it was then.
Sure. You cited earlier the accuracy of police shooting.
Yes.
In terms of actually hitting the target. And I asked the same
about the military. About military. Yes,
shooting.
You're right. I don't know what the data is of accuracy.
I'll throw this
out at you. My understanding is that history buffs, Battle of Cersei, Agincourt. Anyone know the war?
Mm-hmm.
Which war?
Agincourt, was that World War I?
100 Years' War.
Yeah.
We're back to
bows and arrows, muskets.
Yeah, 1400. Any history people? Gosh, I've lost it. My understanding is that 1 in 10 arrows from the English longbowmen, 1 in 10 found the mark.
What about the French crossbow?
That I don't know. It was pretty much unaffected, and the French crossbowmen got their butts kicked by the English archers because rate of fire, 10 arrows a minute.
Outranged
them substantially. Okay, go to Waterloo. Remember this one?
Yeah, Napoleon.
Napoleonic Wars,
1812.
Yeah, around there. I'm trying to think of specifics again. I got to brush up on this one myself. I was hoping there were history majors here. Come on, give me a hand. Throw me a bone. Okay, 1 in 100 bullets found the mark. Vietnam, 1 in how many?
600.
10,000.
Oh, because he linked spear
rate
fire.
Right. We had a new idea of suppressive fire that we could fire, not really trying to hit anyone, but we'd like to, but we could keep everyone's heads down while we advanced.
But again, how much of that was, we couldn't find the VC because they were...
Yeah, it becomes very a complex thing, and I guess what I'm trying to prove my point is here, is how do we count accuracy of soldiers who are actually not firing so much to hit, but to suppress enemy action?
Mm-hmm.
So it's difficult. If we go back to actual accuracy of like bolt action rifles, there's an account of a French infantryman from World War II who could fire, I think he was firing close to 40 rounds a minute, having to reload 6-shot clips and could make a hit every time on a man-sized silhouette at 300 meters. A bolt action rifle. Okay.
Sir, do you mean hit as in kill hit? Or
at least hit.
I was going to say, if you look at the scale, it looks like accuracy would decrease by the numbers of what a trained soldier would be. I mean, for World War II, we're finding the the Wehrmacht were trained soldiers, if you look at the kill ratio and the
They're all pretty close.
You would have to say that it would increase.
You would think it would, but it seemed to be the same. And I think in large part because soldiers are just as terrified as police officers are. They're often firing at far longer distances than police officers are. They're using suppressive fire. All these sorts of things that really aren't designed so much to make a hit as to enable other military actions which will allow for victory. My point again is it's really hard to measure all of this. And I'm not claiming I've got absolute truths here. I'm claiming that we have some indications. Now, one of the interesting things here concerning lethality, and I'm going the wrong direction, is the common folklore now, both of gun people and anti-gun people, concerning the AR-15. The rifle right now, of which there are 8 million at least of which in the United States, the rifle for which most anti-gun groups are most opposed to, the rifle that has been the infamous star of almost all of the mass shootings that we've seen, especially those at schools. Why is this used? Why is it believed to be especially lethal or especially unlethal? Well, first, let's take and explore the AR-15 itself and some of the truths and mythologies about it. And when I say mythology, I don't mean myth in the same way as Zeus or Poseidon. I mean mythology, a belief we have that is sacred, and we hold it to be true, even though we may not have any evidence or very weak evidence that it is true. But we believe it to be true. I can think of no other firearm that has more myths about it than the AR-15. First, the biggest myth. What does AR stand for? Thank you. What do most of you think it stands for? Automatic or assault rifle. Armalite. It was the name of the company that produced the gun. What then do we know about this round? Well, I passed around that little baggie. I told you we'd get back to that. Okay. Which one of those is the round for the assault rifle, the AR-15? It's the 223. Which one of those was that? Let me, okay, I probably should have said, for those of you who don't know firearms, which one? It's the small bullet. It's not the big bullet.
Big one's used for a rifle, isn't it? Big one's a
380. Yep. So you were seeing this round and this round.
Next one on
380. Okay, let me pause on that part. This is a very common deer cartridge used for mid-sized game. You could also take elk with it quite easily and a lot of African plains game. It's plenty powerful. This is the 5.56 round. That's the millimeters, 223 in English standard. We should have stuck with metric. It's a lot easier for cartridges. Let's take a look at this from a ballistic standpoint, looking at kinetic energy of these rounds. Kinetic energy, mass times the velocity squared. Kinetic energy of the typical 223 round, 1,070 pounds of force. Kinetic energy of the 308. Double. In fact, the kinetic energy of the 223 is so small in comparison to typical hunting rounds that in most states in the country, or at least it used to be most states, it could be changing now because of new bullet technology, you're not allowed to hunt with a 223 with most AR rifles, against deer. It's not considered humane enough to kill a deer. One of the biggest mythologies that these lunatics have, and some gun people have, is that, boy, this is an incredibly powerful round, and it's a great round that I can use to protect myself with. It can be, but there are other rounds, if you're worried about pure power alone, are much better. And in most cases, well, I shouldn't say most cases, in some cases may well stop an opponent, a bad guy, much faster than would the 223. There are many instances of American troops being killed because they shot an enemy two or three times in the torso and they kept coming with the 223. Now, one of the reasons that this happens is because the bullets that you're required to use in war are non-fragmenting, non-expanding. They don't get any larger when they hit the body. On the other hand, hunting rounds do expand and are designed to create a mushroom shape, so they create a far larger cavity and cause far more damage in the body. So one of the reasons why we see a deadliness from the .223 in some cases is because different types of bullets are used. I hate to say this because it's hard to make it sound right, but we've been fortunate to some extent that if these terrible tragedies had to happen, that they happened with people who kept using military surplus type ammo. The death toll, the injuries that turned into death, the injuries that became far more severe would have been much more so had these people not been using this type of firearm and weapon. Excuse me, more carefully, not using this type of ammunition. We're going to get into the aspect of, well, yeah, but that .223 has 30 rounds ready to go. And how does that make a difference? It can, and it may not. And it might make all the difference. We have to examine the circumstances under which that firearm is used, the physical, mechanical interaction between the two. What is an assault weapon? Well, the media has a definition for it. Gun owners have a definition for it. The military has a definition for it. And they often are very different from one another. As we know, assault weapon or assault rifle today, this tends to be the cultural normative description. From a purely vocabulary-oriented approach, this is a bad term. It's not accurate because it confuses people. Because true assault rifles have machine gun capabilities, or what's known as burst capabilities. We know what a machine gun is. You hold the trigger back and the gun keeps firing until it runs dry. You just hold it back. A burst mode, you hold it back and it fires two or three rounds all by itself. All assault style rifles are semi-automatic. They do not have machine gun mode. They do not have burst mode. What that means is you have to pull the trigger every time you want a bullet to come out of the gun. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't achieve high rates of fire with these guns. With training, it's not that hard to get four or five bullets out in a single second with your finger. The question is, were they accurate bullets? We know from machine guns that the more you try to use them, the less accurate you become with them, because guns are not stable platforms. They vibrate. They move because of recoil. One advantage of the AR-15 or the M16, I should say, on full auto is that because it's a small cartridge, it doesn't recoil as much. It's easier to control in those kinds of modes. But even then, your odds of missing go up substantially because it's difficult to keep a moving, jumping object on target. Some of the other things about assault-style rifles that that do make them hazardous, and in this case, more lethal towards other people. And this is it right here. This is the only feature that makes an assault-style rifle truly more dangerous than any other gun out there. It's the detachable magazine. The magazine is the part that holds the cartridges. The typical AR can be had with 5-round magazines, or 10-round, or 20, or 30. There are also variations that will even hold 60 or 100 rounds. The shooter in Aurora, Colorado movie theater, who went to see what movie?
Dark Knight Rises.
There's my film buffs. Okay, he had what was called a Betamax, which holds 100 rounds. It jammed. Fortunately, it jammed, because he may have been able to kill or injure far more people if that hadn't been the case. What are some of the things that are considered to make something an assault rifle, but really, under common mythology, the common mythology is these things make these guns more dangerous, when really, from a practical standpoint, they do not make the gun more dangerous. The first are the telescoping or folding stocks. These are military features, usually the telescoping stock. And the reason the military adapted them is the soldiers come in different sizes. Soldiers also wear body armor sometimes, which makes them bigger, and they need shorter guns to help fit them. it doesn't increase the lethality of the gun. And if I usually take one with me, but I didn't want to commit a felony by bringing one here tonight on campus. I'd really like to keep my freedom. There's no way to hold one of these unless you're wearing a Keanu Reeves kind of black matrix waistcoat, which would be really cool. And he held a lot of guns under that thing. But you still can't hide one of these firearms with that thing. The other thing that allegedly makes these guns more lethal is the pistol grip. You see the examples. It doesn't at all. It makes them a little easier to hold long durations of time, but there's nothing that you can do with that gun that you can't do almost as easily or even easier than you can with the other firearm, whether you're firing around walls, hold up on that, over top, or so forth. Go ahead.
Personally, I'd rather hunt. I hunt.
Sure.
I'd use the one without the pistol grip.
Yeah, a lot of hunters find them much more practical for those situations.
The only thing it does is it makes it a little bit more accurate because you get more stable on a pistol grip, depending on the shooter.
It depends upon the mount, too, and what you're doing it.
Yeah.
There's times when this gets in the way.
Truly, yeah.
You know, and it may actually decrease your accuracy. The other things are the little flash suppressor on the end of it, which, by the way, in no way hides the flash from the other side of it. It helps a little bit for the shooter, so if you're shooting in dark conditions, you're not quite as blinded by the muzzle flash. Now, at this point, I usually have several people, and I understand fully why, say, hey, you're just trying to defend the AR so you can keep them, and you know, this is the NRA line. I despise the NRA with all my heart. I've never been a member. I believe that they are one of the worst organizations to support gun rights, even though I believe in them. But I also despise all of the anti-gun groups that I'm aware of because they keep bringing up things that are technically inaccurate and trying to confuse the issue on this. This is one of the things that gets brought up here on this here. The problem is, and this is where I'll tell you, I'm not trying to defend the AR. If I'm saying this gun isn't any more lethal than any other gun, then think about what that actually means. I'm saying any gun could commit these same sorts of tragedies that we see happening. And I'll give you an anecdotal example of that. A couple weeks ago, maybe you saw the mass shooting in a Seattle mall, a Washington mall.
Seattle.
A guy walked in with a Ruger 22, tiny little round, probably about the least powerful bullet you could go out and buy. And he was 5 for 5 in kills. It doesn't take an assault rifle to kill people. And to concentrate on that part, if you're concerned about the mechanics of firearms, it doesn't make sense. We need to look at other firearms too, if that's what you believe the action should be. If that is the limiting action, then you're being way too narrow-minded to only look at assault-style rifles. You need to go after all guns. Now, why then, oh, by the way, bayonet or grenade launchers? My civilian ARs that I use for competition, and we don't use bayonets or grenade launchers. They're still on there, though, because they're tactical.
You don't have the license for the grenade launcher, do you?
Yeah, I don't think you can buy the ammo for it, though.
I didn't get, like, 37 millimeter.
Yeah, but flares, though.
Flares.
Not the real boom. So then, and then a legitimate question is, like, why would any hunter want an AR? Because you can't use them for deer in a lot of states. I'm not sure about Vermont. Is there a restriction on caliber in Vermont?
Nothing extraordinary.
There isn't in New Hampshire. It's one of the few states you can. And with the right bullet, a 223 is plenty humane for deer. But here's one of the things that makes ARs possible, is that it's very easy to change calibers on them.
Well, you can use AR-10.
Or you could go to a version of this which shoots the 308, which you saw. But the thing why hunters have them is this. Imagine, and I used this example earlier, walking into, what type of car do you drive? Do you have a car?
Honda.
Okay, walking into your Honda dealer tomorrow and saying, give me those tires, that engine, those seats, and 15 minutes later they got all installed. And then on your way home, you stop at the Ford dealership and you say, ooh, I really like that steering wheel and I want those brakes. And you buy them and you go home and 15, 20 minutes later, you've got them all installed. We've just described what the AR-15 is like. It is a Lego kit for grown-ups.
Well,
It is the most modular, easy to work on firearm in existence. And it's also relatively cheap. And because it fires, in most cases, this little 223, that's the cheapest centerfire rifle there is to shoot. If you want to go out and shoot a rifle, you could be talking as much as $40, $60 for 20 rounds till you go buy a 223. Now you're talking about 1,000 rounds for $300. So this is why people use them. You may think they still don't need them. That's okay. But this is why they have them. And with a little simple conversion, you now have a pretty good sporting rifle. I don't use them to hunt with, but I do use them in competition. Did I see a hand back here? Anyone want to ask a question at this point? This is one of the things here that we have to think about carefully. It's with the mythology, both real and imagined beliefs about aspects of firearms. And this speech has been the hardest I've ever had because I could go on here for 3 hours about something new every 5 minutes. I've had to narrow it down to this, so I'd be more than happy to answer other questions about other aspects of mythology, but let's talk about this for a second. This is the real interesting issue here. And it'd be especially interesting if it were so dangerous and terrible in the long run implication. What about high capacity magazines? I've argued that assault rifles are in many cases no more dangerous than any other rifle, but in some cases they are. Perhaps many cases they are, depending upon the circumstance. Why? Because you get this high capacity aspect. But my argument is that in some cases they aren't. Perhaps many cases. That's what I'll try to talk about here with this. Anyone know this movie?
Spectre.
Wow, you're good, man. this was a... Yeah, the train scene. This is a very specialized handgun. 1,200 rounds per minute. It's 15 rounds in a second. Touch the trigger, and the fewest you could get off is probably 5 or 7 rounds.
If I remember correctly, during the car chase, he had, if you could go back to the other thing, he had the drum clip as well.
Oh, did he have a
he had that right near the
automobile. Oh, cool. Okay. We never see this in the movies, and we never see that for the AR-15 or the M16. We see people seemingly firingly endlessly like that. No, it takes magazines to do this. And you can very easily fire up, the M16 will empty a magazine of 30 rounds in a little over 2.5 seconds, or about 2.5 seconds. Then you got to put a new one in. Wow, that's a lot of ammunition downrange very quickly. And one of the arguments, and it makes sense, in gun control laws, well, if we limited magazine size, we could prevent some death and destruction because they would have to stop and reload more often. The problem with that is that reloading a modern firearm that has a removable magazine is quick. I could take any person in this room and within 5 minutes of instruction teach you to reload any one of these firearms with a removable magazine in under 3 seconds. And with a little bit of practice, you'd be down under 2 seconds. And if you practiced a lot like I do, you're hovering a little over 1.5 seconds. What are the odds of you reaching me in 2 seconds, seeing that I've opened fire on the crowd and I've had a jam or my gun has run empty? Do you think you can get to me in 2 seconds? You're not going to. Now, does that mean we shouldn't limit rounds? I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is to not understanding how quickly you can be reloaded, that's a problem when you're starting to think about what we do with capacity. Hunters don't need 30-round magazines. I don't need 30-round magazines. The biggest I use are 10-round.
You don't want to use multiple rounds in your hunt.
But one of the things is that I can take and reload that gun so quickly with 10-round magazines, you'd never know the difference. Again, we talked earlier about if I'm really trying to hit something, that's as fast as I can fire. And this is from the U.S. military over years and years of study. This is how fast a qualified rifleman can fire and hit a target every time. Usually it ranges of 100 meters or perhaps a little bit more. If you're trying to shoot very quickly, you're at that 45 to 60 rounds per minute with one reload. But those rates don't change. So when we talk about, oh, these guns allow you to mow down people indiscriminately, not quite the way that we think they do. It depends a lot upon that shooter. The guy was 5 for 5 with a little Mickey Mouse squirrel gun. He had a large capacity magazine in it. He didn't need it. Pistols, I'm going to come back to this, are about the same. Note, I can get off 60 rounds pretty easily in a minute with three reloads, because it's so quick. Yet, if I'm trying to hit people every time at combat effective ranges for a handgun, which is going to be under 25 yards, usually 15 and less, I'm at this 12 to 20 round rate. Yes?
What's an LCM?
I'm going to jump back to that one right now, and I'm glad you asked that. A large capacity magazine, which often called a high capacity magazine. I'm going to give you a study here, and it's the only one that I know that has been done, and it's by a gentleman who is one of the few to study this. I don't know whether to believe him or not, because it's the only data I have. And he's been accused of being biased. I don't know if he is or isn't. But I tried to check this up as much as I can see, and I think there's some legitimacy to what he had to say.
Is that from John Lund?
It's one of his, it's Gary Gleck, who has occasionally worked with Lott. So he looked at these mass shootings, and he took 23 of them between 94 and 13. Only one incident where somebody was able to stop someone. Now, this isn't good data because we're only talking 23 incidents. It's not enough for statistical reliability, but it's the best we got. By the way, does anyone know the mass shooting that where this occurred, where they actually stopped the guy in the middle of a reload? Gabriella Giffords. They're not sure if he ran out of ammo or if he experienced a jam. He was using an extra high capacity magazine for a pistol, one that actually sticks out from the bottom of the pistol even more. Instead of it holding 15 or 17 rounds, the normal loadout for that type of Glock, it held 30. This is the interesting part, though, too. In all of these incidents, the shooter possessed multiple guns or multiple magazines. It wouldn't have made a difference if these were 5 rounds or 10 rounds. If he had to, the gentleman here is rushing me, and I'm fumbling the reload, he just grabs the other gun. They call that a New York reload. Drop the one you got, grab another. New Yorkers out there, anyone? Woo-hoo! Yeah, not sharing that one. For that thing, just cheer in New York.
We know.
Okay.
We know.
At these mass events, these shooters also shoot slowly enough that it doesn't matter what type of firearm they have. I'm not trying to defend high-capacity magazines, high-capacity firearms, or say that we should keep them around. Personally, I don't have much use for them. Even the competitions where I use them, they purposefully load us down. We never go out with 30 rounds to start with. They give us like 10 because they want to force us to manipulate the gun and to do reloads. That's part of the fun. Can you manipulate the firearm quickly? I've never used a 30-round magazine in situations like that. But if we're going to think about this kind of thing, we need to know what they can and can't do and how they may or may not affect mass shootings. Here's the citation from that if you want to get Gleck, but he is one of John Lott's compatriots. So we were talking about this idea here of stopping a shooter from reloading, and if maybe afterwards we'll do a talk here, and if I could get a Wi-Fi connection here, I can show you some people actually reloading old cowboy-style guns very quickly, or shotguns very quickly, one round at a time. Faster than you could ever possibly imagine. The ability of people to learn, even revolvers. This is my colleague, Chad and I. Chad can fire 6 shots, reload the firearm, and fire another 6 shots in under 5 seconds.
Oh my God. Individual or speed clip?
A speed loader, the plunger type. Not like, there are people using other types of loader systems. that can fire 12 shots with a reload in under 3 seconds. I am really hard. I'm not sure I could do that. Yeah, I might be able to do it with a semi-automatic pistol. I've never tried it, but some of my other times possible. All right, we've reached the Q&A time. Let's take our 1 minute break. We'll come back, ask some other questions, and go from there. We're ready to rock? Okay, so he was asking me a great question. Do you ever see any movies where theft guns were realistically portrayed all of the time? No, I haven't. I've seen moments in many films that were reasonably accurate, and others where it wasn't even close to that. And for people who believe they need a firearm for self-defense, it's kind of scary. Because I meet a lot of people who go out, they make the decision, I want to have a gun in the house for self-defense, and they have this expectation that this is a problem solver. And it may not be. It may work successfully for them. It may not. It may get them into a crap load of trouble because they don't understand the law about the use of lethal force. You cannot shoot someone for stealing your TV set in your house. But there are people out there who believe that. You cannot do it. It has to be in a self-defense, a legitimate concern for self-defense. Yes. Yeah, the person points a gun at you, now it's legitimate use. A woman, home alone, I break in your house, Gail. I'm substantially larger than you. you could use a firearm against me legally in many cases, and there would be zero questions asked. On the other hand, you come into my house, I can't. Until you have a weapon in your hand. Disparity of force. That's part of the law. And many people don't know these kinds of things about firearms and what you can and cannot do with them. Yes, please.
Why do you think television movies choose to not portray weapons and how they work?
Because it would be boring. We'd be watching people reloading a lot. We'd be watching people miss a lot. Yeah, it would just make for an awful story.
Oh my God, I think so.
Yeah. Right.
Well, like you were talking about before, it's not just the movies, it's also the video games and the reality around that. So it's way some of the... I have a question for you, though. And the statistics that you were showing before about the different injury rate, kill rates, to what extent can any of that be attributed to better protection, better armament of the soldier?
I stopped at Vietnam because of that, because at least in the earlier parts of the war, there wasn't body armor at all. Later on, it began to be adopted, but I'm cheating with it a little bit, but it wasn't always in wide use, nor was it appreciated. If we went to do that today, we couldn't, because the body armor has made a huge difference. In fact, that most of the injuries now tend to be to extremities, especially the head, which is why we're seeing so many traumatic brain injuries coming out of this war. It's because the only way you get hit anymore is in the arm, the leg, or the head. So amputations, disabilities, those kinds of things. Yes, sir.
Noting in your introduction that you are a skeet shooter, how about shotguns?
Oh, great mythology on shotguns. The first mythology is that... Yes. You know, you six people right here are all threatening me, and I just point at it, boom, and you're all dead. Or I shoot him at this distance, and not only does it kill him, but it takes out a good part of the wall. No. You know what the actual spread of a shotgun is?
Basketball.
With shot, the little bird BBs, as well as with defensive rounds, multiple balls, what we call buckshot, might hold anywhere from 7 to 12 of them or so. It's 1 inch per yard.
Oh, my God.
That's it. That's all the more it spreads. So at this distance, which is about 5 yards... I've got a pattern that big.
Or smaller.
Or smaller.
Because it still could be, because at that range, it's still in the shotgun.
It depends upon the load. But even the shot might spend that much. So I still have to aim. And what's a typical living room? Here to here? I'm now at 10 yards, 10 inches. Well, I don't have to aim as close, but I still have to aim. So the myth is, oh, get a shotgun. You don't have to aim. Crap, that's bullshit.
But it's still...
Now the problem, the great thing about the shotgun is if I hit him anywhere, the threat stopped. It is the most powerful civilian weapon that most civilians own. And even if you have shot designed to kill a little quail or something that was designed for manstopper, at usual combat ranges, they're all equally deadly. All of them. Now, here's the bad part about that shotgun, is that to use one effectively and quickly is very difficult. It takes a lot of training, a lot and lot of time.
And a lot of bruised shoulders.
And a lot of bruised shoulders. It is uncomfortable and painful to shoot full power loads. I actually have a chart somewhere. It's can imagine being hit by 75 pounds in your shoulder. That's what it is. Somebody just went, bam, as hard as they could in your shoulder. That's what it takes. With a full power load. Now, I shoot skeet, as you say, and trap. And on some days with trap, I'll shoot 300 rounds in one day. Mm. Well, I couldn't do that, but it's not a defensive load. It's a target load.
Yeah, or a duck round.
Well, duck road even more powerful. Yeah, it's up there with turkey loads and defensive loads. It's brutal. So we have some really ridiculous mythologies about shotgun. But you want to talk about effective, the stopping a threat? Mm. Oh, yeah. But you better know how to use it. Mm. Now, one of the things people say, well, they're slow to reload. Not if you know what you're doing. People can literally throw in a single shot, bang, 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 one at a time.
Look at that, you got the competition guys who do the trick loads.
Competition guys with trick loads. Load a gun with 8-12 rounds in like 6 seconds. Holding 4 shotgun shells in one hand and sliding 2 in at a time. Click, 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 click. There's 8 rounds.
Look at those cowboy people.
Or the cowboy people. Yes, sir.
This goes back a long way, because this is a particular firearm I've been interested in for a long time, the Brown Bess musket.
Yes.
What do you think, give or take, the distance from here? If I was going for that fire alarm on that back wall, what have we got, like 40 yards?
70%.
No, that's not even that far.
No,
that's about 20 yards, yes.
What do you think?
You wouldn't hit it.
Shots?
You wouldn't hit it.
No.
You probably wouldn't. You might hit it once, because that was a smooth.
There's no rifle.
It's a smoothbore barrel. Its sights are relatively primitive.
So it's going to spray.
It's difficult to shoot accurately because it doesn't automatically go off as soon as you pull the trigger. There's a little delay. You got the flintlock. Right. Well, you've got a wad to keep that, or a patch to keep that in.
So maybe if I were lucky, I'd get once.
Yeah. But see, why those things were effective was because they were huge balls.
Right.
Huge lead. Very heavy, moving at reasonable speeds.
They were moving about 800 feet a second.
Yes, about that's right. And now imagine 50 men all being lined up and firing at approximately the same target. Basically, they're giant shotguns. We've turned men into shotguns. And they're very effective at 50 yards. But after that, and having fired originals from that period, at 50 yards, it's a crapshoot whether you hit a man or not. It's pure luck.
We loaded a buck ball on it.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I'm not quite sure how I should articulate this question, but in U.S. culture, we love guns. And what about other cultures, like in Western Europe, where maybe there isn't quite as much of a love affair? Is it, why are there fewer shooting deaths? I believe there are, so I'm not the expert that you are, but I believe there are fewer shooting deaths in Western Europe than there are in the United States. Is it the culture, or is it the gun laws that really?
I don't know, ma'am, because I'm not an expert on that aspect of criminology, of sociology and death like that. It's multiple factors, you're right. For one thing, it's very difficult to own firearms in most European countries.
To acquire them.
To get them.
The market for guns there is higher than some drug users.
So that's part of it. There's a huge cultural difference. We know differences between Canada and the United States. They have the same media, the same habits. They watch, they have similar types of gun ownership. Not identical, but they don't have the shooting problems that we do. So there's some indication that culture is the biggest thing. But we certainly know that if you take away all the guns, and you really take away all the guns, as Australia did in large part, you can limit mass shootings. Now, you'll have to make a choice if that's what we're going to do. It could be a solution. I don't know how many of you ever take away all the guns in this country, though. My understanding in Connecticut right now, after Sandy Hook, there were a lot of laws passed that made it illegal in the future to own assault-style rifles.
Yeah.
New York just passed that law too.
Right. And what they did was they grandfathered it backwards. If you own one now and you live in Connecticut, you have to register it. Mm-hmm. The word we get, but no one's officially tallied this, and you'll find out why in a second, is that the compliance rate is about 20%.
Yep. It's that high.
That's if that high.
Last I heard, it was a lot lower.
Yeah. But who knows? Because how do you go out and survey people and say, are you committing a felony today, sir, by not registering your AR? Of course I am. You know, they're not going to tell you that. And some people will tell you they are, even though they've never owned a gun in their life. We're in a weird situation. And one of the things that we think we have to figure out is that as the law is written right now, firearms are legal. But as the law is written right now, the government has the ability to place restrictions upon guns. And both sides in this issue have to realize that this is the law right now. And if we're going to have any sort of solution, it begins with recognition that guns are allowed, they can be restricted. And then we have to talk about this in a way that realizes the practical as well as the theoretical and the fact that we need to do something. I don't know what we're doing and
gun safety. I mean, as much as you
it would help. We know that there are lots of children getting hurt every year. And one of the most effective things we've had with that is to make it mandatory for people to lock their firearms up.
I was going to say, I joined the NRA when I was 12. I know your stance against them. My dad and I joined the war and how to be safe with guns. I disagree with their politics probably as much as you do, but...
Yes, and that is the best part of that organization.
I like learning how to be safe with a gun.
As they say, I'm not an NRA member, but I had to take one of their classes to become a range safety officer,
yes,
to have the training to do that. Mm-hmm. That's my only affiliation with them, apart from when I do some competitions, my scores get sent in through the NRA because they sanction the competition. So, I don't know. Yes, ma'am. So... Is your question is that how can we stop the killing if we don't stop the guns?
Or start checking people who have guns. I mean, New York just passed, Cuomo put into effect that law that if a psychiatrist suspects someone of having inclination to harm themselves or others, the psychiatrist is required by law to report it to the police.
Yeah, right. Most states have that.
But and that's so existed for...
It's actually enforcement now.
Yeah.
How can we stop shooting?
How can we stop shooting if we still have them?
Yeah.
We've known that other countries have been able to do that, that still allow. I think it is possible, but certainly it would be an easier way to stop the shootings if we could take all the guns away. But right now the Constitution says you can't do that.
Is that you,
Bobby? Yes, that is. That's a high power competition. You're seeing me shoot at an 8-inch target 200 yards away off you.
CMP competition. Yep.
Yeah, the service rifle matches. Yeah. So that lovely blue outfit I'm wearing is literally a girdle that cinches up you real tight so you stand real nice and straight, and it helps you.
Yeah, those things look really uncomfortable. What about the gun laws that are already there? Right? In Illinois, you have to have a license from the state police to land a background check through that to own fire.
I don't, you know, again, I'm not an expert on the effectiveness. I wish I were, but it's a whole other field of study for me. And I'm starting to veer away from it a little bit as a journalist, but I'm trying to educate other journalists. The one thing that I know is happening, it seems like that gun laws have become the bargaining chip in any sort of criminal case. We've got you on armed robbery. Plead to armed robbery, and we'll throw out the gun charge.
Because Illinois, so if you don't have that gun license, it's a felony. Plus, if you commit a felony with a firearm, it's even more time. And then I know there's the federal statute. So.
And those things often get thrown out because prosecutors want the courts can't get through all the cases.
Yeah, and they want the fast case.
And they want the fast case. And unfortunately, that keeps getting, there's a solution possibly there that could fix it.
And they're doing
a lot of that.
In Illinois, they're doing a lot of that. They're actually destroying out the...
And again, I'm starting to sound like the NRA here, just existing, you know.
God,
please shoot me.
Take a minute to get to the media part of you know, what you touched on. Well, we do have a fascination with violence in our media, and with making it look as sexy and is inaccurate, as you point out. So what on that side, I think that's, we were speaking before about the cultural difference. You know, I think our rating systems, you could be a PG film and be really violent, but you can't have any sex in it. So I'm wondering to what extent there's where that actually plays in. That gets into the what could we be doing thing, which becomes
right.
The political side.
At least you're dealing with the media, which hopefully I have some clue at. I don't know. Again, I think it comes back to a cultural thing. In Canada is maybe our best case. They're watching the same media. They've got guns too, but they're not doing this.
Yep.
So there's something. Well, it may be. You know, these things tend to be contagious too, just like suicides. You have a suicide at a high school, the odds of having another suicide within the next week are like astronomically increased. Yes, sir.
It happens that I've known Canada well for about 55 years now, though I'm not Canadian. Canada does have, and has had during that whole time, much stricter gun control than here. And yet in recent years, it used to be that shootings there were essentially unknown except for domestic violence and hunting accidents.
Right.
And of course the police in justifiable situations. Now increasingly there are shootings in Canada, apparently because of, since the gun control has remained constant, it would appear to be social attitudes.
It certainly is an indicator, you know. You yeah. We have to get past the passion part of this to fix it. And if we can just calm the hell down a little bit, then maybe we can get somewhere. Jeff?
I was going to say one more question.
Okay, yeah, I kind of figured we'd be close. Has anyone got a last one to go with here?
Are you available to teach?
We'll see. I'm talking to you. Yes, sir.
It was funny that Gail read my mind right as she was speaking about the question. But yeah, you were talking earlier about the cultural ramifications, and I'm wondering, after you spoke about the honor society in the South and the diaspora that kind of spread, do you think that that's related to the anti-intellectualism that's also kind of cropped up, which also kind of feeds into these myths about guns?
We had a previous question here about culture and impact on guns, and one, there's a new sociology model out now that says our issue on these is violence is culture oriented. It is not due to poverty, it's not due to many of the other things. And what the argument was is that Southern culture, where honor was everything, to where you met on the fields of honor if somebody would insult you in some way, is still alive today in America and personified again in media of the West. And it was also transported north by the black diaspora of the 60s and 70s. Southern culture wasn't just a white culture, it was a black culture. It didn't matter the color of the skin, that attitude raised. And now that happened in violence that we saw in the 60s and 70s in the cities, and we're seeing a continuation of it through the gang movements. That's the theory from that. So to come back to your question here, again, is probably what?
Do you think that that honor culture kind of seeped into the anti-intellectualism that's also affected a lot of myths on issues?
I can think of several tie-ins with the Trump campaign.
No. I was thinking about that too, but we were going to stay away from politics.
Yeah, so that, but I can think of tie-ins. That's all I'll say from that.
But there's the campaign, and then there's the American culture as a whole that we can talk about in regards to that issue.
Things have changed.
And our guns being taken away for the last 8 years. So that was our campaign.
I love sarcasm, as you could probably tell, and humor in general. I thank you all for this opportunity. It's been a wonderful honor. Thank you for having me.